Hi, my name is Dr. Padia. I'm a professor of computer science and psychology, and I study how people reason with data visualizations. I wanted to talk today to those of you who are getting into data visualization, and I wanted to give you some words of wisdom from someone who has taught data visualization for many, many years now. So I'm going to share with you the top 5 things that beginner visualization designers do wrong. And if you do any of these things, no shame. I did them myself when I was beginning, but I wanted to illustrate how they could be a little problematic and how you can quickly advance past them to be the best visualization designer that you can be. All right, the first thing that beginning visualization designers do wrong is to put too much into a single display. Let's look at an example here. Here we have a visualization where we're showing 9 different groups in one frame, and we're plotting a density plot, which is showing the overall proportion of different values within this group. And it's layered, where each group is layered one in front and behind another, okay? So it builds up a visualization like this. This is too complex. There's too much going on, and there is what we call overplotting. That means that too much information is plotted in such a way where information occludes something else. For example, group, I want to say 3 is at the very, very back, and it all of the other density plots are in front of it, making it where you can't see that visualization at all. So what do you do? Well, there's lots of different strategies, but I think one of the things that beginning visualization designers fail to appreciate the power of is simply breaking the visualization apart. So here we have an example of a ridgeline plot where it takes the exact same densities, but it stacks the densities one on top of each other. So you can kind of see each one in its fullest. There's still some overlap. There is still a little bit of occlusion, like what's going on between group 3 and 4. They're not fully overlapped one on top of each other. This allows you to control the amount of overlap that happens, and it allows you to easily distinguish the different groups. What happened with the first visualization is that you'd have to look up the color and find the color in the legend. With a ridgeline plot, each of the lines has a different group organization, so you know which group you're looking at. That's one way you'll deal with it. Another way is to simply break the density plots or any of the visualizations that you're using into different charts. This technique is called small multiples. It's where you take individual groups and you put it on different panes of an image. And this can be very, very effective. It might seem like it's a little complex, but the vast majority of work finds that this is a very successful visualization technique in comparison to overlapping visualizations. Now, the second thing I find that beginning visualization designers do is they fail to appreciate the power of the sort. It's a very simple thing that can be so important and be so useful for when you're communicating to other people. For example, we have that ridgeline plot that I made before, and right now it's organized from group 1 to group 9. That's how it just automatically organized those different groups. Oftentimes, if you don't change the default, it will organize information in alphabetical order, which may be what you want, but generally isn't what you want. Instead, you want to think of a strategic way to sort the data in such a way that facilitates your user's task. You want to have an understanding of what people will likely do with your visualization and sort the data to make that as easy as possible. In this version, I just sorted based on the mean density value for these different groups. And that allows us to do things like look at the highest density and the lowest density and see the relative comparison. I also remapped the color to emphasize that sort function where the highest density values are in dark blue and then the lower mean density values are in yellow. Very simple technique, but oftentimes beginning visualization designers miss this one little step that can really make a visualization that is kind of messy to be very clean and easy to understand. The third thing that I find that beginning visualization designers commonly do is they try to zhuzh up their visualization by doing things like adding 3D or animation or color, all of these things to kind of make it look fancier. There are some very serious issues with arbitrarily adding 3D to any type of visualization. I'm illustrating one here with a pie chart, which is the most infamous version. On the left, we have a flat pie chart where you can see the different proportions. And the right, we have a 3D version that has depth and then it is rotated in space. What I'd like you to notice is the size of the gray section in these pie charts. On the one on the left, you can see that It is not the biggest proportion. The orange is the biggest proportion of the pie, but on the one on the right, it is actually kind of hard to tell. It appears a little bit like the gray portion is the largest proportion. Now, I've show people these slides all the time. There's thousands of examples online, but somehow beginning visualization designers have a really hard time grasping how this happens. So I put together a visual aid. This is a little paper pie chart that I put together. So I want to start by just showing it to you flat, right? All of these have the exact same proportion. And as we start to rotate this, as this part that's further away from you in space becomes more angled, notice that it's proportionally smaller than the areas in front. As we rotate and rotate, these areas will take up a larger proportion of the light that's reflecting literally onto your retina than this area in back. And as you start to do that, what happens is our mind starts to fail to appreciate that the smaller portion of orange that's literally hitting our retina doesn't necessarily account for a smaller portion of the pie. We start to get a little bit confused perceptually. So that's really what's going on here is as this 3D pie chart is rotating in space, we have a different amount of information that we are intaking and it fools us a little bit. This is an easy example because you can see they're all, you know, equal proportions. But with a more complex example like we have on the screen, it becomes very tricky to tell what the differences are. I think it's important to realize as you are learning more about data visualization, you inherently have to learn a little bit about visual perception. And some of the things we know in visual perception is that when things are closer to us, they appear bigger than things that are further away. So if you can remember that when making visualizations, that can help you ensure that you don't see these types of errors where you accidentally represent something bigger that's closer because it's in 3D than something smaller that's farther away, which will get people confused because it's very hard to map those visual illusions to data representations, which are inherently graphically created. They're not a physical thing in the world. There's essentially a mismatch between what we've created and our expectations based on how our visual system works. Along that same lines of things that beginning visualization designers do too much of is to focus on animation once they figure out how to do it. Animation is so cool and so exciting. Once people figure out how to do animation, they add it to everything. But the truth is you don't always need animation and it can often be counteractive to your goals in terms of your design. For example, we have a static version of this small multiple visualization that we made earlier, and then we have an animated version that's just animating the plots appearing and disappearing. Now, the one on the left, the animated version, is a little bit more fun and interesting. You might think that it's telling a story or it's revealing information. No, it's not doing anything like that. It's just animating each of these plots in. But all of a sudden, you might as a viewer, feel like you're something more is being communicated to you or it's more engaging. So don't fall prey to that. Only use animation when you have a very clear reason to do so, not just to make it more fun or more flashy, because it often has a negative effect in terms of making the visualization harder to read or longer to read, which is often not what you are looking for. Also in that same line, people that are beginning in data visualization tend to use color a lot, really rely heavily on it. Here's an example of the Human Connectome project where they are showing these neural pathways with different colors, and it is beautiful. This is one of the most beautiful visualizations that exists, but what does the color mean? It's impossible to understand what this color is actually depicting other than just, you know, making it beautiful. So you often see people jump to something like this because it truly looks lovely, but the color is not communicating anything that is meaningful to us. So don't get seduced by color making something impressive or scientific or aesthetically pleasing if it's not necessarily adding on additional functions. Maybe that's your goal, is just to be aesthetically pleasing and you want to make a beautiful art piece, as is done here. That is fine, but just realize that simply adding a bunch of color to a visualization to kind of spruce up an otherwise boring visualization. Maybe you could spend your energy putting more insights into the visualization and making it more meaningful for the user rather than just making it a little bit more visually exciting. The fourth thing that beginning visualization designers often do is they expect people to carefully read captions or additional supplemental information. For example, here is a hurricane forecast visualization produced by the National Hurricane Center. It is showing the trajectory of a storm path. I want you to look at this and tell me how much larger the storm is getting over time from the day that it starts to 3 days into the future. Just take a look and tell me how much larger the storm is growing over time. Okay, did you get it? Well, this visualization communicates nothing about the storm size. It is rather infamous, and it's one of the visualizations I have studied in the past. And what we found is that when people look at this, they see the size of the cone growing over time, and they assume it represents the size of the storm. When it represents nothing about the storm size, it is actually conveying the trajectory of the storm. So you were not able to answer the question, how much is the storm growing in size over time, because it's not conveying any size information at all. You would know that if you carefully read this caption. And I think this is a really interesting example of how if you didn't read this caption, you would fully get this visualization wrong. And what we found in empirical research is even when we provided captions like this and explained to people how to read them, they still miss this information. So if you're making a complicated visualization where it is dependent on readers reading these captions to understand it correctly, you might be making a mistake. There will be some readers that do not read your caption. So rather than leaning so heavily on the caption, maybe consider modifying the visualization so it doesn't rely on a caption, so it isn't so heavily dependent on people having read those words. We have alternative hurricane forecast visualizations that don't have this misconception of the storm growing in size over time, and that's the type of thing that we recommend. The fifth thing that beginning visualization designers often don't rely as heavily on is a little bit counter to the thing I just said. And it is that they often don't focus that much on annotations. So what is an annotation? An annotation is when you draw a label or draw an additional piece of information directly on the visualization itself. So for example, you might have a visualization where there's a key data point or a key group of data that you want people to focus on. If you want people to focus on it, you can draw a little mark around those and say, focus on these data points, they mean X. Okay, that's an annotation where you're directly drawing on the visualization to provide additional information. Why is that different than a caption? Well, when people are looking at the main part of the visualization, they will use that text to interpret those individual data points. It's not as if it's adding supplemental information at the top or the bottom. It is integrated into the visualization itself. And recent empirical work finds that it helps people interpret a visualization more effectively, and people prefer it. They prefer the maximal amount of annotations compared to less annotations. So they like it when you are helping them interpret the visualization. Now that might feel a little nerve-wracking as a beginning data visualization designer, because you might not want to tell people how to interpret your visualization. And that's fully understandable. I think you want to add those annotations in when you have a strong sense of the important information that you don't want people to miss, and they will appreciate that you guided their attention to that relevant information. Those were my top five things that beginning visualization designers often miss. If you have any more questions or comments about learning data visualization, please comment down below. I'll make more videos based on your comments, so if there's anything specific you'd like me to address, I am happy to do so. Thank you so much for watching this video, and take care.